Tonight we're in chapter 21 here in the book of Ezekiel. We're going to look at verses 8 through 32. I'll begin reading at verse 8. I'll read verses 8 through 13. We'll get into our study. Ezekiel 21, beginning at verse 8. Again, the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, prophesy and say, Thus says the Lord. Say a sword is sharpened and also polished, sharpened to make a dreadful slaughter, polished to flash like lightning. Should we then make mirth? It despises the scepter of my son, as it does all wood. And he has given it to be polished, that it may be handled. This sword is sharpened and it is polished to be given into the hand of the slayer. Cry and wail, son of man, for it will be against my people, against all the princes of Israel. Terrors, including the sword, will be against my people. Therefore, strike your thigh, because it is a testing. And what if the sword despises even the scepter? The scepter shall be no more. Now, as we were looking at the first seven verses last time, let me refresh your memory. I pointed out that the phrase, the word of the Lord, in this one chapter alone is used three times. It was used in verse 1, it's used again in verse 8, and then a third time this phrase is used in verse 18. And as I was introducing this to you, I wanted to emphasize the fact that God had a specific message. That's why it's referred to as the word of the Lord. He had a specific message that he was bringing to the nation of Israel. And so he wanted Ezekiel to preach a message. And the message that was going out to this nation, the nation of Israel, was one of impending judgment. This judgment that God is bringing on the nation is going to affect Jerusalem, its holy places. It's going to affect the entire nation. Now, it's going to be carried out, and we're going to see this in a moment. It's going to be carried out by the nation of Babylon. But in reality, God is behind this judgment. We saw that in verse 4, because the Lord is saying, I will cut off both righteous and wicked from you. And so, though judgment is coming and it will be enacted through a nation called Babylon, God is saying, listen, it's not up to Babylon to make this judgment. It's not Babylon who's bringing judgment. God is saying to the nation, I am the one who's bringing judgment. Now, you see that kind of sentiment in the Old Testament book of Deuteronomy in chapter 32, verse 41, where God there says, when I sharpen my glittering sword and my hand grasps it in judgment, I will take vengeance on my adversaries and repay those who hate me. And so God is saying, judgment is coming. Ezekiel, let them know this is the word of the Lord. Judgment is coming, but make sure that they understand that it isn't something that's human in origin. Let them know for sure. They need to understand that the judgment that's going to be coming against the nation, the judgment that is going to come against the city of Jerusalem, those holy places and all that have been dedicated to me, this judgment that is coming is not coming through the hand of man alone. They are simply my instrument. They are going to be wielded by me because judgment, God is saying, comes through me. Now, as he's giving this message, I pointed this out to you, that he was to do something. Notice verse 6 here in Ezekiel 21. He said, sigh, therefore, with a breaking heart, sigh with bitterness before their eyes. And God had said, listen, I want you to sigh as if your heart is breaking, because that's going to communicate two things to the people. One, it's going to communicate my grief, God's grief, because God is not rejoicing to bring judgment, because it's God's desire that people should repent everywhere, that they should come to know him. It's not God's desire that people should be lost and perish and enter into eternal damnation. That's not God's desire. It's God's desire to see people saved. That's why he has said to them, why would you die, O house of Israel? Turn from your wicked ways. So it's not something that God desires to bring. And so when you give this message, this is not a message you're smiling about. This is not a message that you're going to make jokes about. This isn't the kind of message that you're going to try and win them over with your personality and your illustrations. This isn't going to be something that you're going to bring to them in such a way as to be winsome to them so that they might admire you. Ezekiel, when you come and bring this message, it's not to make friends, it's to bring a warning. And when you bring this warning, I want you to sigh with a broken heart, because you're going to be communicating to them my emotional state, if you will, concerning having to bring this judgment. It's not something that God wants to do. They're going to ask you, why you sign? Because as you answer them, you'll be saying to them, I'm signing because one, God is bringing judgment, and two, your heart is going to be breaking when it comes. So one, not only is God's judgment going to come from a broken heart from the Lord himself, but two, those who are going to be experiencing his judgment will also be broken. One of the things that I mentioned last time was that God was having Ezekiel experience something that was within God's own heart. The most effective ministers, the most effective individuals used by God are the ones who actually get in the same page with God. It's the ones that are moved most by the Lord. I heard somebody, or actually this is an old statement, I read somewhere where somebody had once said, I don't want to listen to somebody who doesn't weep when he speaks about hell. Because that's what really ought to motivate us as ministers, is a sense of identification with the people and an understanding of how lost they are. You know, the Lord has been trying to teach me that for so long. He hasn't succeeded. I suspect that when I finally get it, I'm going to die. Because I've been waiting a long time to get it. Because I get just as frustrated as anybody else, I have to tell you. I mean, I didn't even know that driving could be a trial. But it is. You know, I don't know. Anyway, so I've been asking the Lord to help me to experience the things that he experiences, in the sense of, Lord, teach me to weep for the lost. Teach me to care about them being lost. Help me not to become hardened, because God knows I can. I can. I can get so tired of the way people are, so tired of the whining and the complaining and all of that, that I can finally just get fed up with it. And so I'm asking the Lord, God, keep my heart soft. And that's basically what's going on here. So the ones who are used the most by the Lord are the ones who have the Lord's heart in the matter. When the Apostle Paul was speaking to some elders in the book of Acts chapter 20, some elders from the church there in Ephesus, he said to them in Acts chapter 20, verse 31, watch and remember that for 3 years I did not cease to warn everyone night and day with tears. I didn't cease to warn everyone night and day with tears. You know, sometimes people don't understand why ministers sometimes like me and others like me can get caught up, that when I'm sharing that I can actually become emotional about it. They don't understand that. I was teaching at a pastor's conference about 20 years ago. And as I was teaching at the pastor's conference with about 700 pastors and assistants, I was sharing out of Acts chapter 20. And as I was sharing with these ministers, I had one of those moments of emotion where my heart was revealed for a minute and tears did flow. And later on, some pastors were saying, what's he crying about? I mean, what's that all about? I have to tell you, not everybody has gotten to the point where they actually care about people going to hell, that they actually weep for the lost, that they actually are concerned for the estate of people's souls. Even pastors sometimes can become calloused. And yet when Paul was speaking to the Ephesian elders, he said, I warned for 3 years, night and day, and I did so with tears. Ezekiel is to grieve. Ezekiel's to grieve because the sword has been drawn. Judgment is certain, and that's what we're looking at. And so we pick up verses 8, and it says, the word of the Lord came to me again. Now God's instrument of judgment has been prepared. God will soon bring judgment on Israel, and it's the king of Babylon who's being referred to. It's the king of Babylon who is this sword. It's the king of Babylon who is polished and sharpened. Because you see that in verse 19, son of man, appoint for yourself 2 ways for the sword of the king of Babylon. And so that's what's happening here. God is saying, I'm going to bring this judgment, and it's sure. Now, I want you to notice something here. I want you to notice how he speaks of this sword. He says the sword is sharpened and it is polished. Now, I don't know, did anybody bring a sword in here today? Yeah, you can say, yeah, I did. Yeah, lift it up. Go ahead. All right. That's cool. You got a sword, right? I got a switchblade. But we did bring a sword in here. And, but in a literal sense, of course, the only sword we have is one inside the foyer, and this one in front of us is a symbol of the Word of God. Of course, we don't run around with swords, but perhaps I have some people here who are swordsmen. Maybe I have somebody here who's a martial art kind of guy or a woman, and you've been trained in the use of a sword. I may very well have some. I do have some in this fellowship who are trained in that way. And so you would understand this better than the average person. Because when it comes down to swords and everything, all you need to do is watch some of these learning channels, which I do sometimes. That's how bored my life is. And I'll watch the Discovery Channel, and I'll watch how the samurai, how their swords were crafted, and I just am amazed. And they speak about how long it took for them to make the sword, and how sharp that sword ultimately is, and why they polish it, and all. And so it's speaking concerning the fact that the sword is going to have a glittering effect, but beyond that, it shows that it's cared for. It shows that it's polished. It's cared for, but it's prepared and sharp because it's a cutting instrument that is going to be used in a mighty way. And so that's what's taking place here. What you have is a picture of sword that's coming that is going to be a firm and sudden and a very powerful judgment. And it's going to come through the hand of the king of Babylon. This is a prepared instrument of destruction is what he's speaking about. Even as a warrior prepares the sword for battle, which will ensure widespread slaughter, even so, that's what God is going to do. He's going to bring this king and this military might against the nation of Israel, and they're not going to survive. Now, it's interesting, as this is being spoken, I want you to see in verse 10 how the question is asked, should we then make mirth? Now, we don't use that phrase. When's the last time you talked about making mirth? I don't use that word, but we know what it means. It speaks about partying. We know that word. Should we party? Is what's being said here. Listen, judgment is coming, so should we go out and party? Is it a time for us to go out and enjoy ourselves? Is it a time for us to go out and party and take this lightly? See, what's happening is they're living in an imagined sense of security. They're thinking everything's fine. They think that things are cool. There's no problem whatsoever. So they're in an imagined sense of security. And he's saying what is going to happen is you are going to be overwhelmed. Isaiah in chapter 22, verses 12 and 13 says, in that day the Lord God of hosts called for weeping and for mourning, to tear out your hair and for girding with sackcloth, but instead joy and gladness, slaying oxen, killing sheep, eating meat, drinking wine. And he went on to say, let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. And that's a philosophy that many people have to this day. Eat, drink, be merry. We're going to die tomorrow. That was the philosophy of the Greeks. The Greeks had no concept or desire for anything beyond what they had right now. It was all for the moment. It was all to enjoy what you have right now. Eat, drink, you're going to die tomorrow, so you might as well grab as much as you can right now. That's exactly what we as Americans have found ourselves entering into, is a mentality like that. What's the big deal? Just go out and party until you die. What's the big thing? We can party like when the Titanic went down and the band kept playing. We can party. And that's what's happening. That's what's going on. God is saying, listen, I'm telling you, judgment's going to come, and you're talking about going out and partying. You're not taking these things seriously, in other words. When Jesus was speaking in Luke chapter 17, verses 26 and 27, Jesus said, as it was in the days of Noah, so it will be also in the days of the Son of Man. They ate, they drank, they married wives, they were given in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark and the flood came and destroyed them all. Everything went on as usual. Usual events, weddings, partying. God had, through Noah, been saying to them, judgment is coming. Noah, we know the story of Noah, had been commanded to build that ark. He's referred to by the Apostle Peter as a preacher of righteousness, one whose heart was grieved. And he went out and he shared that there was an impending judgment. But the people laughed at it. They said, right, really believe that. Continued on until the day that the flood came, God closed Noah and his family in the ark, and the rest of the world was overwhelmed by a flood. So God is saying, listen, people aren't going to listen to you. They're going to think that you're very wrong, probably even crazy. But you need to go out and share, and you need to tell them, because it's going to happen. You see, in verses 10 and 11, he says, it despises the scepter of my son as it does all wood, and he has given it to be polished that it may be handled. This sword is sharpened, it's polished to be given into the hand of the slayer. It would seem that the people in Israel were thinking that they were safe from harm. When he speaks of a scepter, we know that a scepter is a symbol of authority. So, in essence, what is being said, it would seem, is that they think they can disdain the power of foreign kings. Now, wood is what scepters were normally made out of. So God's authority is being portrayed here as being greater than Babylon's. Because the fact is, God's authority is going to be wielded here, and God has already given this sword to Babylon. And Babylon is going to come and is going to destroy. Now in verse 12, cry and wail, son of man, for it will be against my people, against all the princes of Israel. Terrors, including the sword, will be against my people. Therefore strike your thigh, because it's a testing. And what if the sword despises even the scepter? The scepter shall be no more, says the Lord God. Ezekiel, once again, is commanded to reveal his grief. Now, it's not just Ezekiel's grief. It's not just a human grief. See, that's the difference, guys. I mean, sometimes there's this human compassion and human sorrow, this human disappointment. You know, as a parent, your child, your son, your daughter may do something that was just wrong, greatly disappointing. You take it so personally. As a matter of fact, it becomes an issue that really becomes between you and your child. And you're angry and you're hurt and you're feeling frustrated about it, but you take all the responsibility for it and you fail to realize that when your child sins greatly, it's not just against you. The real grief shouldn't be just the sorrow that you have and the disappointment you feel. If we're mature in the Lord, we're going to get to the point where our sorrow is really on the Lord's behalf, because my child has sinned against God. Not just against me. So Ezekiel is revealing grief, but it isn't simply his grief, though he identifies with it. But what he's doing is revealing the sorrow of God, because God is bringing judgment. He's saying that the sword of Babylon is going to be victorious over the king of Judah, and the king of Judah ultimately is exiled. And if you take notes, you see that, and it's recorded in 2 Kings in chapter 25, and that's what the Lord is saying. The scepter shall be no more. He goes into exile. Well, verse 14, you therefore, son of man, prophesy and strike your hands together. The third time, let the sword do double damage. It is the sword that slays, the sword that slays the great men, that enters their private chambers. I have set the point of the sword against all their gates, that the heart may melt, many may stumble. It's made bright, it's grasped for slaughter. Swords at the ready. Thrust right, set your blade, thrust left, wherever your edge is ordered. I also will beat my fists together, and I will cause my fury to rest. I, the Lord, have spoken. So when he says, strike your hands, it's another picture of grief. And so he's saying, I want you to show grief. And then he says in verse 14, the third time let the sword do double damage. This doesn't speak simply of the three invasions that Babylon had invaded Israel three times, but this speaks of finality. It's the sword of judgment, and he's saying the sword of judgment is going to fall on all, both small and great, because it's God who's bringing the judgment. That's when he's saying, I will beat my fist. I will cause my fury to rest. God is bringing judgment. Verse 18, the word of the Lord came to me again, saying, and son of man, appoint for yourself two ways for the sword of the king of Babylon to go. Both of them shall go from the same land. Make a sign, put it at the head of the road to the city. Appoint a road for the sword to go to Rabbah of the Ammonites and to Judah into fortified Jerusalem. For the king of Babylon stands at the parting of the road, at the fork of the two roads. To use divination, he shakes the arrows, consults the images, looks at the liver. In his right hand is the divination for Jerusalem, to set up battering rams, call for a slaughter, lift up the voice with shouting, set battering rams against the gates, heap up a siege mound, build a wall. And it will be to them like false divination in the eyes of those who have sworn oaths with them. But he will bring their iniquity to remembrance that they may be taken. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, because you have made your iniquity to be remembered, in that your transgressions are uncovered, so that in all your doings your sins appear, because you have come to remembrance, you shall be taken in hand. So this is what he's doing. He's diagramming a route of the king of Babylon. What he's been commanded to do is to mark the ground, showing the king leaving from Babylon and coming to a fork in the road. And what he's doing is he's marking out two capitals. One, capital of Israel, Jerusalem. Two, the capital of the Ammonites, Rabbah. And so what's going to happen is he's portraying the king as standing there having to make a decision. Now notice verse 21, it says, the king of Babylon stands at the parting of the road, at the fork of the two roads. To use divination, he shakes the arrows, consults the images, looks at the liver. Interesting, huh? Looks at the liver. What's that all about? I hate liver. What he's doing is he's deciding which place to destroy. He has two options. Should I go to the capital city of the Ammonites, Rabbah, and destroy them? Or should I go first to Jerusalem? Which place should I go? So we have here, once again, an illustration. You have this, the beginning point, Babylon, and then you have the line, and then you find the fork in the road. You have one pointing towards Jerusalem, one pointing to the capital city of the Ammonites. And so you have a picture of the king there saying, I'm not sure which one I'm supposed to destroy. So he goes to his religious people in his kingdom, and he has them divine. What he has is, and I want you to see this here, this is how he did it, is he uses divination through shaking the arrows, consulting the images, or looking at the liver. When it speaks of shaking the arrows, it's commonly believed that what this means is you had two arrows placed in a quiver, and it was shaken around and then thrown, and one comes out, and the one that comes out, he picks up in his right hand and looks at it, and it has the name of the city that he's supposed to go to. So he uses that as whatever comes out first is the one that the gods would have me go first to. Well, that's not enough. And so the second thing he does is he goes and consults his images. And there's really no information that I could find on exactly how that was taking place. It's very possible that he had some kind of household god, some kind of idol that they would consult in some way, and he was asking for direction. The looking at the liver is another way of divination. Is they would remove an animal's liver, and they would look at it for certain markings, and they would use those markings as a way to make a determination. And so the whole point that's being made is that he's using divination to try and determine what he's supposed to do. Now, in verse 22, when it says, in his right hand is the divination for Jerusalem, it would mean that the arrow that came out is giving him direction to go to Jerusalem, and this is what he'll do. He'll set up a battering ram. He's going to call for slaughter. He's going to lift the voice with shouting. He's going to set battering rams against the gates, heap up a siege mound, and he's going to build a wall or a fortress, and that's exactly what takes place. That's what he did, and that's how he went in and invaded. You see that again in 2 Kings chapter 25. Now, this is how the people will respond. In verse 23, it will be to them like a false divination in the eyes of those who have sworn oaths with them. But he will bring their iniquity to remembrance that they may be taken. The Jews who are seeing the king come and marching against the city are going to be thinking, he's relying on divination. He's got false gods that he's trusting in. There's no way that we're going to fall. We've made our oaths. You see, the king over Judah at that time, Zedekiah, had made a treaty, an agreement with the king of Babylon. And so they're saying, we have made our oaths. We're gonna hold fast to them. But they're not aware of the fact that Zedekiah had broken his oath against that king. And so he comes in, and he's going to destroy them. But the people think they're not going to end up destroyed. And so, in verse 24, therefore, thus says the Lord God, because you have made your iniquity to be remembered, in that your transgressions are uncovered, so that in all your doings your sins appear, because you have come to remembrance, you shall be taken in hand. Your iniquity, I want you to see that. You have made your iniquity to be remembered. You didn't get away with it. You didn't get away with it. Your sin, your wickedness, your iniquity demands a response. It demands a response not only from the king of Babylon, because Zedekiah had made an oath to him, an oath of loyalty, and he had broken it. But it's not just the fact that you had made an oath, sworn an oath, and broken it. It's not just what you've done that deserves a response from Babylon, but it's what you've done that deserves a response from God himself. As we've been going through Ezekiel, you've seen that God has said to them, I'm going to bring judgment because you have given yourselves over to idolatry. You have forsaken me and pursued the gods of foreigners. And as a result of that, I have brought and will continue to bring judgment on you. You don't see it clearly for what it is. But God's saying, but I have. I've uncovered it. You know, one of the hardest things in the world is to finally admit you're wrong. To finally admit you were wrong. That you did something wrong. Here's some tidbit from ancient history from the 70s. There was a guy some of you have heard of. His name is Fonzie. The prophet Fonzie. From Happy Days. You remember Fonzie, that guy? There was one word that I still remember. I used to watch Happy Days. There was one word that he couldn't get himself to say. And what was it? Anybody remember? I was wrong. He could never say that. I was wrong. That's what he would do. I was wrong. He couldn't say he's wrong. We see humor. I saw humor in that because I understand that. Because human nature being what it is. The hardest things in the world for you to admit is you're wrong. Any married couples in here? You ever have a fight? Nah, never do. But theoretically, let's talk about my marriage. I've had one. To admit you're wrong. To admit it, to say, I am wrong, without saying, but you. See, the reason I'm wrong, and yes, okay, I give up. It's been 25 minutes. Okay, I'm wrong. But there's a reason. And the reason that I did that is because you, and that's how it is. Because you did this. Listen, if you wouldn't have done that, I wouldn't have done this. We wouldn't have a fight. Okay, yeah, I'm wrong, but you are. And that's kind of what we do. You know, I'm wrong, but you're wrong too. And that's why a lot of the fights are never really ended. They're just postponed for another day. I mean, it's going to come out again. Because nothing changes. Because we really don't think we need to change. You see, if you saw me as I see me, then you'd agree with me. We wouldn't have a problem. And so what you have to do is you have to mature to understand that you're living with somebody who's as perfect as I am. When you finally come to understand that, we'll get along. I'm wrong. A kid does something wrong, the parent begins to speak to them, the kid keeps saying they didn't do it. They didn't do it. When they finally admit that they did, it's because somebody else made them do it. If you've got more than one kid, you've got a built-in excuse in the house. If you got just a one kid, that kid's busted every time. I heard about a little boy. Well, the father was saying that the house was broken into. And he was telling this audience, you know, my house was broken into. He said, and he says, it's a weird thing because, he says, I didn't lose the VCR. I didn't lose the DVD. I didn't lose the widescreen TV. I didn't lose the computer. Didn't lose my cell phones. Didn't lose any of the money out of my wallet. The weirdest thing, he said, is the burglar. All he wanted to do was come in and pee in my son's bed. Because when he, this little boy had an accident, and the daddy had walked in there and said, what happened, son? I don't know, a burglar came in and peed in my bed. It wasn't the little boy. It was the burglar. He said, the oddest thing, didn't steal anything, just had to go pee in my son's bed. He said, the funny thing is he took my son's pajamas and threw them under the bed, too. It's just an amazing thing. Even the small things we don't admit. Even the small things we don't like to admit. The reason I hit her is because she hit me. The reason I hit her is because she was looking at me. She was looking at me. Everybody knows that's a capital offense. If someone's looking at you, you ought to hit them. We don't admit that we're wrong. We don't admit it. It takes the Holy Spirit of God to grab hold of us and keep us from moving long enough for us to say, you're right. Sometimes it takes years of patience on the part of God for somebody like me, somebody like you, to finally say, you're right. And the funny thing about that is we think that we've been getting away with all these things for all these years as if nobody knows, when in reality, God has known all along. And that's what he's saying. He's saying your transgressions are uncovered. There's nothing hidden from God according to Hebrews 4:13. Everything's naked before him. The psalmist in Psalm 90, verse 8, says it like this, you have set our iniquities before you. Our secret sins in the light of your countenance. Secret sins. What an interesting way to put it. Some men's sins precede them. I mean, you see somebody walking down the street and they're all doped up or drunk. You see somebody on the street, they're trying to pick up a prostitute. You're talking to somebody and they're all flushed out and they're swearing at you. Their sins are pretty open. You can see that. They're not hidden. They're open. They're in the open. You see it clearly. You don't say anything to them at that moment, perhaps. It's probably not wise to confront them. But you see it. But there are other people that when you see them, you wouldn't know that they had some hidden thing going. I mean, that's how it was during the time of Jesus, wasn't it? You had those Pharisees, those religious leaders. That Jesus was the only one who could really refer to him in the way that he did. He spoke of him in this way. He said, you are hypocrites. You're wearing a mask. Because you're saying one thing and you're doing another. And they're the ones who stood on the street corners and they're the ones who prayed at certain times of the day so that people would go by and say to themselves, it's prayer time, I should have prayed. Look at how righteous that one is. He's taking time to pray three times a day. They're the ones who, with great openness and in such a way as to be seen by others, would take their gifts and give them to the poor. And people would say how generous they are. They are so unbelievably generous. And they're the ones who would actually fast more than the law required. And yet Jesus said they would disfigure their face so that they would be seen by men to be fasting, meaning they would walk around with this real sorrowful look in their face. And people would say, what's wrong? Oh, nothing. I'm just fasting. And Jesus said, these are the ones who receive the reward from the attention they get for doing that. But listen, during the time of Christ, when Jesus said, unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you've got no chance of entering into the kingdom of God, the immediate response of the disciples was, then who can be saved? Because when it came down to it, they had the most open appearing religious life of anybody in their community. These are the people who are the most respected. They had the secret sins. And when Jesus came and spoke to them, he said, you're like whitewashed tombs. You are clean on the outside, but on the inside, you're filled with decay and all manner of dead men's bones. You're the kinds of people who will go across the world to make one convert, and when you've converted them, you make them twice the child of hell that you yourself are. You're the ones who strain at gnats and you swallow camels. You tithe of the mint and the herbs and all kinds of those things, the small things, the inconsequential things, but you've forgotten the weightier things of the law, like love and justice and those things that really matter. You don't do those things, but you do the others. Hidden sins. Hidden sins. How many times have I, in the past, gone to a church service when I had a hidden sin? Things that I thought nobody knew. And I forgot that God did. God did. All things are open before Him. We have to be careful about that. Because we think that we'll not be found out. And God is saying here, oh no, you have been found out. I definitely know about these things. And I definitely am bringing judgment. Ecclesiastes 12:14 says, God will bring every work into judgment, including every secret thing, whether good or evil. God will bring every work into judgment. You see, that's why grace changes things. Because we're not trying to make ourselves better. We are simply those who admit that we can't. That's why I cast my cares on Him, because I know that He's capable of handling them because He cares for me. That's why we came to faith in Christ. That's why we didn't try to become religious. That's why we didn't go that route. Perhaps you tried to for a while and realized that there was just no way that you could be a perfect person. And you were somebody in desperate need of help. And that's why Jesus came, in order that He might give you the ability to do that which you desire, but have the inability to perform without His help. If I don't give my heart to Christ, I die carrying those sins and ultimately they're revealed in judgment. But when I give my heart to Christ, God washes me clean of those sins and I become a brand new person. And so Christianity is built on not human effort, but the work of God on our behalf. Here, God is simply saying to this nation, your transgressions are uncovered. I will deal with you. Now, verse 25, now to you, O profane, wicked prince of Israel, whose day has come, whose iniquity shall end, thus says the Lord God. Remove the turban, take off the crown, nothing shall remain the same. Exalt the humble and humble the exalted. Overthrown, overthrown, I will make it overthrown. It shall be no longer until He comes whose right it is, and I will give it to Him. Now this is interesting. This is a prophetic word. This word specifically is to the king, King Zedekiah, and he's being judged for unfaithfulness to God and to man. But notice how it says remove the turban. When it says remove the turban, the high priest wore a turban. And when he says take off the crown, that speaks of obviously the king. So you're looking at the religious leadership as well as the political leadership. And he's saying this is all overthrown. Remove it. Now it's interesting how he says nothing shall remain the same. Notice how he says, I will make it overthrown. It shall be no longer until He comes whose right it is, and I will give it to Him. And what he's speaking is prophetic. What he's saying here is that the office of priest and the office of king is never fully restored, even after the Jews return from captivity, Because in reality, that doesn't take place until the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. When he's saying, overthrown, overthrown, I will make it overthrown, it shall be no longer until he comes, whose right it is, he's speaking of the return of Christ. He's speaking of Messiah. Now, even after the Jews return from captivity in Babylon, the offices are not ever what they will one day be until the day Jesus Christ actually rules and reigns. And so what he's speaking concerning is the office of the high priest and the king. And he's saying that neither of those will be fully restored until Jesus Christ comes. Now, on one occasion, Jesus was speaking. If you take notes, it's found in Luke 21, verse 24. And Jesus said there, Jerusalem shall be trodden down by the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled. What he's speaking about here, when he's speaking about the kingdom not having its impact until Messiah reigns, is he's speaking about a time that is referred to by Jesus as the time of the Gentiles. Jerusalem is trodden down. It was trodden down by Nebuchadnezzar. Nebuchadnezzar began to rule as the greatest king that ever lived, but he was representative of the greatest Gentile kingdom. There were other kingdoms that followed after him, the Medo-Persian, the Greek, and the Roman. This is the rulership of the Gentiles in the period of time that the Gentiles will have sway. But ultimately, in the future, the times of the Gentiles come to an end. Jesus, in his second coming, establishes his kingdom. So Jerusalem will remain desolate until the Jews recognize Jesus as Messiah when he returns to set up the kingdom. The times of the Gentiles end with the return of Jesus Christ. At that time, the people will look upon him whom they have pierced and mourn for him as one mourns for his only son, Zechariah says. And they will say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And so what is being spoken of here is God is saying the priesthood and the kingship is not going to be ever fully realized until my Messiah comes. That's why he says it shall be no longer until he comes whose right it is. I will give it to him. He's speaking of Jesus. Verse 28, and you, son of man, prophesy and say, thus says the Lord God concerning the Ammonites and concerning their reproach, and say, a sword is drawn, polished for slaughter, for consuming, for flashing, while they see false visions for you, while they divine a lie to you, to bring you on the necks of the wicked, the slain whose day has come, whose iniquity shall end. Return it to its sheath, I will judge you in the place where you were created, in the land of your nativity. I will pour out my indignation on you. I'll blow against you with the fire of my wrath, deliver you into the hands of brutal men who are skillful to destroy. You shall be fuel for the fire. Your blood shall be in the midst of the land. You shall not be remembered, for I, the Lord, have spoken. You see, he says, not only is Jerusalem going to be judged, but the Ammonites will also. What's interesting, and we'll see this in chapter 25, is what is interesting is God actually tells them why that he brings this judgment. It's because when Babylon takes Jerusalem, they rejoice to see the temple and everything destroyed. And God says, I'm dealing with you for that kind of attitude. They were joyful when that took place. Now, when Babylon took Judah, the false diviners of Ammon were giving false visions of safety. So God says, they're lying to you. You're going to be taken into bondage. So you might as well put your sword away because it's not going to do you any good to resist, because your judgment is certain. And there's no escaping it. Now, what's interesting, I don't know, does anybody here know an Ammonite? Anybody have a neighbor, friend, relative, Ammonite? No, of course not. That's what God says. You shall not be remembered, for I, the Lord, have spoken. You're going to be wiped out, and you will no longer exist. And that's what took place with the Ammonites. They no longer exist. Because God was saying that. He's saying, listen, you can't rejoice when my people are being dealt with. You can't be happy and celebrate over the destruction of my people and the temple. You can't. And because you've done that, I will judge you. Now, your false prophets are going to be telling you, it's no big deal, don't worry about it. Your diviners are going to be saying to you, you're okay and you're safe. But the fact is that they're lying to you. If there is such a thing as truth, there is such a thing as a lie. And the biggest thing in the world for you to understand is the difference between the truth and the lie. And the origin. The origin. See, we as believers believe the Word of God because we believe the origin is from God. So God, who cannot lie, tells us the truth in His Word. Now, false prophets may be as sincere as the day is long, but they're still not telling the truth. And God isn't going to judge on the basis of sincerity. His judgment is based on whether it's true or not, because you can be sincere and be entirely wrong. Like that mother whose little boy was sick, and he was coughing, and she had taken him to the doctor and gotten a prescription for his cough. And as he was coughing, she stumbles out of bed. It's early in the morning. She's so sleepy. She goes to the medicine cabinet. She pulls out the prescription, fills up a large tablespoonful of it, gives it to her little one, goes back to bed. In the morning, discovers she had poisoned her own son. With all sincerity, she was giving to that child medicine, but in reality, she gave that child iodine. And she poisoned her own baby. Did she mean to? No. No. With all sincerity, she intended to give him something that was prescribed by the doctor to make him well, but she still gave him the wrong thing. Do you judge her as being somebody who intended? No. She didn't intend to do that. She intended to minister. I was talking to a friend of mine over 30 years ago now, and I said to him, you need to come to Christ. You need to give your heart to Christ. He said to me, you know, I was raised in a particular religious faith. My mother taught it to me. I can't turn away from what my mom taught me. His mother was wrong. She didn't bring him to faith in Jesus Christ. My friend was not a Christian. But my friend wouldn't turn to Christ, he said at that time, because I couldn't break my mother's heart by coming to Christ. I was speaking to another young man, and he said the same thing. I can't come to Jesus Christ. He said, my mom raised me to be what I am. And I said to him, are you willing to go to hell for your mother? And he said, yes. And I said, I wasn't willing to go to hell for my mother. I said, but I was willing to bring my mother to heaven. And the way that she's going to come to heaven, comes to heaven, is through faith in Jesus Christ. It's not your religion. It's your relationship to God through Jesus Christ that we're talking about. Not what your mother gave to you. There are so many people who are so stuck on their traditions that they received that do them no good. We've had members of our church who have told me that their mate doesn't want them coming to church here because it's not the church that they were raised in, and don't want to bring the kids here. Don't bring the kids to that church because I want to take them to my church. Problem is they never go to their church. So the kid is without religious instruction because one of the parents doesn't want to step away from the traditions they've received, traditions that have done them no good. Done them no good. But they don't want to walk away from those things. No, I wasn't willing to go to hell for my mother, but I was more than willing to bring my mother to heaven. And that's what happened in my case. I brought my mom to faith in Christ. And I brought my dad to faith in Christ. And I brought my family to faith in Christ. Because I discovered a long time ago the most selfish person in the world is the one who goes to heaven alone. And I didn't want to do that. You see, God is a righteous judge. Even the things that we think are being done that are right, He knows whether they are or not. And when we put our hope and trust into something other than Him, the only thing He can do is judge us. We can't plead insanity. We can't say guilty with an explanation. It's either did you or did you not believe me? And we can't explain away our problems to God, because at that point, looking into His eyes, we're only going to be able to say, I did believe you, that's why I'm entering into your kingdom, or I rejected you. That's the only answer you can give. I received you, or I rejected you. God says to the Ammonites, your diviners are lying to you, and you're going to be wiped out because you believed the lie and because you rejoiced at the pain of my people Israel when I judged them. God help us to believe the truth and not the lie.